I love the fact that you picked how to enjoy Rotary as the topic for today. You know, in order to do what we need to do, we need to have more people in Rotary. And the best way to get more people in Rotary is to have enjoyable events such as this in our socials, in our service projects. It's interesting because there's several different ways to grow Rotary. We can attract members, bring members in. We can engage those members and retain them, or we can start new clubs. But around all of that is the culture. You know, people don't leave Rotary International. They leave a particular club. And so often when people join Rotary, they don't realize there's a bigger Rotary world out there other than just their clubs. So let's talk about the different ways to enjoy Rotary. So I'm going to share my screen. Can you all see that? Is that screen visible to
you? Yes, we can see you.
Okay, wonderful. So this is a recent trip that President Stephanie and I went to the Philippines, where we're dedicating 250 homes for people who didn't have homes. And, you know, if we want to engage our members, service projects is one of the best ways to do that. So you can do service projects locally at your club, but you can do it in broader areas too. When you think about Rotary, there's several different areas that you can actually enjoy in Rotary. So of course you can join your club. And a lot of areas have several clubs together in an area with an assistant governor. And then you have districts. And districts, there's 525 of them right now at Rotary International. And they're paired into zones. And then zones are paired into regions. So most directors have, there's 17 directors, so there's 34 zones. And then, of course, you could have fun at Rotary International at that level. So let's talk about the different levels and the fun things that you can enjoy Rotary at each of those levels. Now, of course, international service projects is one of the best ways to enjoy Rotary. You know, a lot of members say that they were members of Rotary, but they didn't become a true Rotarian until they did their first international service project. This is a picture of Stephanie and I in Korea recently. We went there and there was an apartment building, and we met a man about my age who came up to Stephanie and he was just crying. He was actually crying because she was the president of Rotary International and she represented all of us and all the great work we're doing. You see, he was living in an apartment with his 85-year-old mother, and the apartment had no electricity and was full of mold. So the Korean Rotarians went in there and they redid the whole apartment. They redid the electrical systems. They painted it, removed all the mold, and now he has a place to live because of wonderful Rotarians. And that's us painting the outside of the building. You know, so there's action groups. You know, there's about 29 action groups, and these are professionals that aren't clubs, but they're professionals who help clubs and individuals organize projects. They are experts in areas. So we have a Rotary Action Group for water, which you see here. This is my first international service project that I took to Honduras to do a water project. So if you need to find an expert to do an environmental project or something like that, you can do that. There's a new Rotary Action Group that's in formation now. There's a group of individuals from around the world who are trying to form a Rotary Action Group for artificial intelligence. And I'm helping that group do that. And we actually go to the programs committee at the end of this month and to a board vote in October. So those are experts that help you with funding, help you secure grants, help you do projects. But then there's another way to have fun in Rotary, and that is fellowships. Now, there's a lot more of these. There's a couple hundred of these. And you can see there's a scuba diving fellowship. I'm excited about the Fellowship for Recreational Vehicles, RVs. They are actually for the Calgary Convention. A bunch of them are getting together, and they will drive their recreational vehicles to Calgary, and they'll have a party. But there are golf fellowships. There's a wine fellowship and a beer fellowship and a scotch-making fellowship. So any kind of recreational activity, hobby, you can do a fellowship. So if you find a club in India isn't doing well and they need to do something different, they can actually become, in some fellowships, you can become a member of that fellowship and have a chapter, like the wine tasting fellowship. So that's another way to enjoy Rotary. There's also something called a Rotary Community Corps. In my district, we took five clubs and put them together to form a Rotary Community Corps for the benefit of Afghan refugees. So we have Rotarians working with a group that is in need of service, and they work together. So the Rotarians stay in their clubs, but they are also a member of the RCC, and the people are being served are in RCC. In this case, we meet every other week at a community foundation, and refugees, our new neighbors in town, they move in. We bring all kinds of job fairs there. We bring elected officials. So these individuals can go there and get a job with a manufacturing company that's being represented. We bring in from our clubs a librarian, so the librarian can actually get them library cards so they have internet. We translated the driver's manual that teaches you how to drive into Pashtun and Dari so they can get their driver's license, so they can get a job, and then they can send that money home. And you're making peace around the world, positive peace, by doing it in your own backyard. So that's another way that you can get people involved and have fun. And it's interesting, a lot of times in our clubs, if you do the same service project again and again and again, people say, well, I want to try something different. So if you do something like this, forming a Rotary Community Corp, then you could actually retain people, because we saw people in these five clubs, even though, you know how it is, after a while, some members stop coming to meetings, they stop coming to socials and service projects. When you bring new life into your club by doing something like this, starting an RCC, then a lot of those people get re-engaged, and they stay in the club, they're happy, they bring in more people. And the other thing is, when you do things like this, you have local politicians come, and your public relations and public image rises in your communities. The other thing you can do to have fun is Rotary Youth Exchange. We have hosted a boy from India, and so now we have friends in India because we hosted Ayush. And there's so much energy that comes with having Youth Exchange, whether that's an outbound that's come back and they're speaking to your club, or if it's an inbound. And don't feel that if your club isn't doing one of these and you feel like you have a small club and you can't do a project like this, partner up with another club. Just like all of you partnered up to host this amazing webinar today, you can host a youth exchange with more than one club. Rotary coordinators. Around the world, we have paired zones. That's made up of a number of districts, and they have coordinators. They have Rotary coordinators that do membership. They have assistant and Rotary regional foundation coordinators who work on the foundation, and they have Rotary public image coordinators and assistants. They also have EMGAs, which deal with major gift givings, and polio and out coordinators. But that's another way that you can enjoy and have fun in Rotary. And peace fellows. We have a new peace institute that recently formed. We're going to do a peace conference there in February 20 through 22nd of next year, 2025. We have over 1,300 Peace Fellow graduates. You can have a master's degree, or you can have a professional development certificate program. Again, another thing that Rotary does. So we need to tell everyone about all these things so they can enjoy Rotary. If they're not happy with the culture in their club, they could do one of these things. So we also have zone institutes. And nobody throws a party better than India does when it comes to zone institutes and your district conferences. So, we just had ours in my zone last weekend. I live in Minneapolis, which is northern U.S. in the middle, right below the Canadian border. And our institute was actually in Texas. But we went there and we got the polio report. We got the five-year financial forecast and video from Julie Burke, who's our CFO and our treasurer, Best Stubbs. We had inspiring speakers. We were able to connect with our friends, talk about projects, and of course, we had fun social outings. We did a boat ride around the river that circles San Antonio. So it was a lot of fun. We also have something called the Council on Legislation, which happens once every 3 years. It'll happen this April, mid-April. And anyone can attend this. Yes, every district has one official delegate, and it has a backup, an alternate. But you can actually be a paid observer for only $60 USD, and you can go for the whole week and see how Rotary changes its bylaws and its constitution, and see how the legislation works. So, you know, that's a lot of fun. Also, we have something called committees. Rotary has a bunch of committees. It has joint committees with the Rotary Foundation and Rotary International, and has committees just in Rotary International. And there's certain committees you can apply for, usually in every July or August magazine, both in the India Regional Magazine and the North America Magazine. They will be a list of committees and you can apply online. So they have finance committee, they have audit committee, they have operation review committee, they have membership committee, they have communications committee. So whatever your area of expertise is, wherever your interest is, you can go to committee meetings. I was there Monday and Tuesday of this week for the Rotary International Membership Committee meeting, and there's people from all around the world that serve on these committees. And Rotaractors can now be appointed to these committees. So they are really a lot of fun. So you spend a couple days there, usually go out to dinner and breakfast with your fellow committee members. A whole lot of fun. And there's something else called a president's representative. So every year there's a Rotary International president. This year it's Stephanie Urchick. And there are 520 conferences around the world. About 420 of them actually want a representative from Stephanie's office to represent her. So you can actually go somewhere around the world and you can represent the president and deliver her his message. And you stay there for the whole district conference, and Rotary International pays for it. Again, it doesn't have to be money out of your pocket, and they are really fun to do. And of course, we have our International Assembly. Every year, our district governors, all 525 of them, I mean, we lose districts and gain districts, and some become undistricted, but right now there's about 525. You can attend International Assembly even if you're not an incoming district governor. It's mostly district governor elects, but again, you can apply to be a paid observer and you can go see the inspirational speakers and get to meet your district governor elects from around the world. It's great. Everyone wears their clothing, their garb from this area. It's just wonderful. Now, we have something in the U.S. called the Pasadena Rose Bowl, and they have a big parade every year. And Rotary International actually has a float. So you can ride on this float. That's actually me, the guy in the top hat on this carousel horse with past President Jennifer Jones and her husband, Nick. It's a really fun time. And I see Lloyd on the call here. He was actually there when this happened. So you can go and watch the parade. You can actually decorate the floats. Every single square inch of that float is some kind of natural material, either rice or flowers. So you can go meet Rotarians from around the world and actually place those roses and other flowers in the float and then watch it. And then there's a U.S. football game after. So there's an international convention. Once a year, we go to a different locale. Our most recent one was in Singapore. It was in Melbourne before that. The next one's going to be in Calgary, and I hope you all come. That'll be a fun time. But you get to meet people from around the world. You get to hear inspiring speakers, not only in these plenary sessions, but there's also breakout sessions where if there's a particular area of Rotary you want to learn more about, whether it be the strategic plan or you want to learn about how to do a project or you just want to learn something that's more entertaining, you can go and really have that cultural experience. Again, people wear their garb from all over the world. And there's a huge House of Friendship, which last year and this year coming up is all put into villages. So if you're into an area of focus, let's say water projects, you can go to an area where all the vendors and the people who work on water projects are together. If you have some other kind of interest, you can go to that area of the House of Friendship. And it's just a great way to catch up with Rotarians from all around the world. So now is my favorite time, and that is answering all your questions, because I want you to come with leaving with the knowledge that you came here seeking. So please ask me what you want, and I'll be happy to answer.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks for that wonderful presentation. I'm sure everybody has enjoyed. If anybody has a question, kindly raise your hand. You will be unmuted and you can ask the question. Yes, Norman.
Hello, Mr. Gump. We met at Manchester. It's nice to meet you again.
Yes.
I don't know if this is an appropriate place to ask, but with the international conventions, is there a facility that we can actually watch them? I can't afford to go to them. So is there some way we can watch them from abroad, please?
You know, there are certain aspects that are videotaped, the plenary sessions primarily. When it comes to the breakout sessions, Norman, what they usually do is the presenters of that can actually live stream it or video it themselves, but Rotary International does not do that. But typically, those are released on the website for Rotary International, and it's usually about 6 months after the convention. So you can't watch them live, but that's just because if you can watch them live, then we wouldn't be able to have enough people come to support the cost of having the convention. And it was great being with you in Manchester. That was
It was very kind. Event.
It was wonderful.
Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you.
Anybody else who has a question, please raise your hand and we'll unmute you to ask. Yeah, Dominica, please.
Yeah, yes, I was going to suggest that another way I have learned to enjoy Rotary very, very much is by attending other people's online meetings. And I think Vijay will agree with me because he and I have got to know each other very well in the past 4 years because of doing exactly that. Both of us have been to hundreds of club meetings. I've been to district events and zone events and presidential installations online since the pandemic started. And it has given me so much insight into what clubs are doing, what Rotary is capable of doing. And not only that, I have made friends online, some of whom I have actually met in person since we've been able to travel again. Thank you.
That is a very great point. And if you haven't been to D'Amico's club, which is the Rotary Club of in Jamaica, Montego Bay, it's one of the most fun clubs I've ever visited. So thank you.
Yeah, Adonis, please.
Yes, you mentioned a lot of opportunities, but I believe some of them have some profile that are required. For instance, you can to be a Rotary coordinator or to be a Rotary international president representative, you must have attained a certain leadership level in Rotary. So That I mean, it wasn't specified, but you passed, you mentioned them across, and it doesn't mean that everyone can just afford those opportunities. It depends also on the certain level you reach. But I know that with DEI, a lot of positions have been opened gradually. For instance, before, to be a district committee chair, you needed to have been a past president. Right now, it's open to even non-past president. So is this thing going to evolve all the way to the board or whatever? That's my concern, my question. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for that question. And we're always evolving. You know, it was wonderful that the DEI, Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, was a task force, and it has now been promoted to an advisory council, which is just below a committee. But they are making recommendations to the board. And I do sit in on that quite regularly. But just look, let's take for an example, Adonis, where Rotaractors are. Rotaractors are where we need to invest in our future of Rotary. And, you know, before 2019, they were just a program. They weren't a full membership type. Now they are. But look at what's going on with them. Right now they're on a software called PeopleSoft. And right now it's hard for our third-party vendors to actually interact with them so they can get information. That's now going to go on the Oracle platform, which is Rotary's platform, where we have Rotarians on it. So they'll be able to do that. Yes. They can now serve on committees. They could actually lead a district committee, and they could serve on an international committee. And good on them. They actually raised $390,000 that they contributed to collectively worldwide to the foundation. But President Stephanie just formed a task force, which Hans Hermann, who's the vice president, is going to study how we can get that going. But just in the last few years, they've been able to, they're now able to apply for or be nominated for every major award. And we've had two Service Above Self Award winners from Rotaractors. They are able now to form their own Rotary Club or Rotaract Club without a sponsor. They're able to do global grants without having a sponsor. And the board at their last meeting voted to have Rotary International Board of Directors voted to have one Rotaractor from each zone attend the assembly in February of 2025. So I think we are making progress. We are moving progress. And yes, you're right. There are some requirements, especially for council and legislation and resolution and for international assembly, but you can still go and watch those. But of course, there's some training that gets that needs to be done in order to actually participate. But thank you very much for the question. And we need to keep on moving forward. We will not be a strong organization if we don't have diversity, equity, and inclusion. And we need to keep working on that, keeping the forefront. So thank you very much for bringing that up.
No, I wanted to add something.
I'm going to say two things. I'm going on Monday to Lincoln in Britain to a university freshers day with the sole purpose of trying to recruit Rotaractors.
What?
The other thing, a sneaky way of meeting lots of new Rotary friends. I've got a list of about 10 talks that I do, and I take them all around the district. Anybody who wants a particular talk, I go and give it to them. I've done some on Zoom as well. And you get a free meal.
Yes.
That is a win-win.
That's wonderful. My son just went off to college a few weeks ago, and he's starting a Rotaract club in his area. So I'm going to see if I can join that, because you can be a member of a Rotary Club and a Rotaract Club. So I know what Rotaractors are really feeling. So instead of just going to committees and hearing them say it, I want to be able to feel it. So thank you for bringing that up, Norman. That's great.
Your pleasure.
Devendraji, PDG Devendra, you wanted to ask.
Thank you very much. Tom, I have been thinking about Rotary's membership not going up. You know, we are stuck with 1.2 million since almost last few years. So what is Rotary International's vision for next 5 years as to, apart from members of the Rotaract, how we can increase new members in, get the new members in Rotary Club and retain them? What is your idea?
Well, you know, that is really a great question. Thank you very much for asking it. And it's interesting because we bring in about 160,000 individual members worldwide, which is not bad, but we lose about 170 each year. And the scary part is we lose 10% of those who joined within their first year. And within their first 3 years, we lose over 50%. So what we need to do is we need to engage our members. We need to make sure that they're all involved in impactful projects that make a difference. It could be local projects. It could be international projects. But in order to do that, we need to innovate. If you look at the way our grants go now, and we're making progress, don't get me wrong. You know, we used to have the matching grants, which were okay. But then we realized we need to do community needs assessments up front and to actually have to be able to recruit new partners. We need those impact studies in the back end. So we went to global grants. Now we're moving to grants of scale, where we have audacious goals. I know we don't have time to talk all of them, but just take the first one. Curing malaria in an entire country. Well, we're able to get partner of World Vision in that. World Vision has more money than Rotary, but what do we have? We have 1.4, 1.2, depending on how you count it, if you include Rotaractors. They want me to say 1.4. And people like you and me are willing to do those projects. So we need to make a difference. The other thing we need to do, to be honest, when you look at the world, this is a gross overgeneralization, but the Northern Hemisphere is not forming new clubs, and it is losing more clubs than it's starting. You look at where you are in the Southern Hemisphere, you are starting clubs and not losing as many, so you're growing. And that's pretty much true, except for Australia, New Zealand, those islands, they're not growing right now, but those are different issues. So if we start more clubs than we lose, we grow. And in North America, I'm sad to say that we only started 52 clubs last year. I mean, there's some districts that do that in 1 year. Yeah. Our whole North America didn't do that. In the last 5 years, less than 50% of our districts started a club at all. Now, why is that important? Because our traditional clubs are great. I'm in a legacy club, traditional club. I would never leave it. But there's potential people of action out there that we can reach and bring into Rotary with all these grants and things like that. But we have to let them serve their way. And it's too hard to get our existing clubs to change. And people like the way they are. So let's start new clubs. So thank you for the opportunity to answer that question.
Yeah. Pranesh, Dr. Pranesh, you wanted to ask something. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Tom, for your very insightful address. And you are really, as always, you have inspired us very well. I am very much impressed with your thought about the RCC. See, yes. In my opinion, RCCs in a community can definitely, wherever the residential localities and apartments are there, they can be very good source of sponsoring a new Rotary Club, which you have very successfully implemented here. This is my one thought. Second is, I would like to ask you, how about attending the International Assembly as a past governor without being a training facilitator, learning facilitator?
There is a place on the Rotary website where you can go and you can look up paid observer for International Assembly, and you can go and you can attend everything other than the actual facilitation that's taking place without the governors. And it is so much fun. And you know, we moved from San Diego to Florida, Orlando, Florida. We say at the Rosen Shingle Creek. It's a great facility. We have a whole section of the facility just for ourselves. And you should really consider doing that as a past district governor. It's a great way to meet the current district governors and other past district governors. And I'd love to see you there in February. We'd have a good time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Norman, you want to say something?
Just one thing. Yeah. I've just started an impact group in off the back of my legacy club. What are your views on impact? I see them as a really positive potential lifesaver for Rotary. How do you feel?
I couldn't agree with you more. So an impact club, it's called different things around the world. The impact is a terminology that they started in North Carolina for a club that's a companion club to a traditional club. And they don't call it a satellite club because the idea is they will always stay a part of the club and never move. So that's why they call it impact club. But they only meet to do service projects. They don't meet to have meetings. You know, once a month they might have a social where they get together with beer and pizza, but they only do service. It has been tremendous growth for a lot of traditional clubs around the world, and it's something that's growing. And I say, sure, go for it. Any way we can make Rotary flexible to have more people of action join us to be a part of Rotary is a good thing. And it's not hard to fill out the paperwork, and it's been successful. Thank you very much, Norman, for bringing that up.
Thank you.
Keep us in the loop on how yours is going.
Of course. I've got two new members inducted next week.
You should call Dave King, the editor of your magazine, and tell him about that, because I would love to see an article in your magazine about that.
Sure. That'd be thank you.
PPVN, you can ask your question now.
Okay, thank you for the insightful lecture. Someone did ask a question about how to retain membership. I'm asking this again. How do you retain membership? You said we should try to carry our members along, get them involved. When you try to get your members involved and they're a bit nonchalant, what other means do you advise to what other means you advise us to use in retaining our members and trying to get them involved and interested in Rotary? Because a lot of people join Rotary for various reasons, and perhaps when they come in and in the first year they don't see any benefits, in quotes, they tend to lose interest. So what are the measures or what ways do you encourage us to retain members in our clubs? Thank you.
That is such a good question. I'm so glad that you asked it. You know, most of our clubs grow because there is a good salesperson or two in the club that is good about asking members. You know, when I was president, I was so excited because we brought in 31 members into the club. And I was talking to a past district governor, and he said, "Well, Tom, that's great, but if you don't keep them and you lose all of them within the first year, what good have you done?" So there's different ways to make them feel like they belong. One of the best ways is, as soon as they come in, ask them what committee they want to serve on. Because if they start serving on a committee with others, they'll have friends in the club and they won't leave. What I used to do when I was club president, every time we had a new member, I would take their picture and I put in a little picture frame, and I would set it at a different table every week so that they get around and meet other people. You can put them in class and give them a class project. I think in India you call it a batch. So if you have a batch mate, of instead of bringing them one in at a time, bring five or six in a couple times a year, and then assign them a class project where they have to work on a project together. Then that way they have their friends and they won't leave. Let's face it, after 3 years, they're like all of us. They're meeting here online, coming to these meetings. They think about Rotary all the time, but it takes a while to get them to feel like they belong. So those are just a few ideas. And talk to your assistant Rotary coordinators and your coordinators, or we could talk offline, or you could email me, and I can give you a bunch of other ways. But the main thing is talk to them. You know, you might want to do a new member survey when they come in and ask them what they're looking for in Rotary. Because let's face it, Rotary is like any other business. You know, if they get value, they'll stay. If they don't, they're going to walk away. And when they walk away, they're not going to say the best things about that about us because they haven't had the best experience. So if we do a survey, ask them what they want other meetings, what they want other socials, what they want other service projects, and we actually listen to them and deliver what they want, they will stay. And, you know, really, as a club or a district, you should do a survey once a year. That's what Rotary says. And why is that? Because there's always people coming in and there's always people leaving. So the culture might be fine today, but when it's new people join and older people leave, the culture may change and they might want something different. So thank you for talking about retention. It's important.
Thank you.
Anybody else has a question? Please raise your hands. Friends, we still got 5 to 7 more minutes. Yes, Sujit. Sutiti, yes, you can, please.
Good evening, everyone, and I'm so excited today that Tom, sir, he's here, back in action. And thank you so much, sir, for such an insightful presentation. And I'm just so honored that I just want to congratulate the host committees who have organized this program, because I just personally want to say I really enjoyed the conversation. And I think I am a very new Rotarian from Rotary District 3291. And I have just joined in the month of February. But I must say that I've been enjoying my experience from day one, because my club has given me all, you know, freedom and all kind of opportunities as a new joining. I have been given opportunities to explore different kinds of service projects. And in the process, I'm also enjoying my work. It's not that I'm just going and doing my work. I'm just enjoying the process of interacting with interactors, starting with interacting with Rotarians. And it's a very good learning process, because I'm also, I have made so many new friends. And some of my friends are here today online. I can see Norman, sir. I can see Tom, sir. I can see Devinder, sir. I can see Kunabesh, sir. And I've met so many people from different parts of the country as well as from the world. They have joined today. It's such an, I think this is in itself, it's so, so enriching, and it's a fun, loving experience, I think. And the presentation, Tom, sir, which you gave, I think it gave me a lot of suggestions and ideas what kind of projects we can also have in our club, so that it becomes interesting for new people who are joining. Because I get requests every day. People come to me and ask me that we want to join Rotary, and do you think we can contribute something meaningfully? So I am really looking forward to, you know, enjoying Rotary and my experience with Rotary. You know, my interaction with senior Rotarians, my interaction with my colleagues and with my within my district. So thank you so much for, you know, doing what you're doing for all of you, what you're doing for Rotary. It's very inspiring to each one of you who is present in this discussion. And thank you so much. And I'm really looking forward to my Rotary journey to make it more exciting, happening and enjoyable as well. Yeah.
Well, thank you for bringing up that good point. You know, every year Rotary International does several surveys, and one is the all-member survey. And we ask people, both Rotarians and Rotaractors, why do you join and why do you stay? Yeah. And the biggest reason is usually fellowship, and even more so for the reason they stay. So thank you for bringing that up. Excellent point.
Thanks, Tom. I think iPhone has her hand up. You can please ask your question.
Yeah, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sorry for not putting my name. My name is Rotarian Kirti Suranjan from District 3234 from India. I belong to Rotary Club of Organ Donation here, and it's an e-club, cause-based club. Tom, I'm very glad to meet you online, and it's been a very insightful journey so far. My question here is that we are cause-based club, and I want to make it more and more vibrant in terms of membership as well. Since it's a very serious topic, we have an action group as well. What more we can add on? Because our CC is also a very wide area to be focused and done. Any other options for cause-based clubs here to make it more vibrant and in terms of membership?
Well, thank you very much for that question. Actually, Anil has been to my house here in Minnesota, spent the night at my house, and he is doing such great work, and you're doing such great work. So thank you for doing that. So for those of you who haven't heard of the concept of a cause-based club, it's a Rotary club that focuses around a particular cause. So its speakers are about the cause. The service projects are about that cause. And, you know, when we were first trying to get those started, there were people saying, oh, we can't have this. It'll be political issues, da-da-da-da-da. But you got to remember, it's all about the service. When it comes to organ donation, that is the one cause that some people want to work only on that cause. You know, if you think about an eco club, or you think about, in our district, we formed the first club ever to end human trafficking, and now there's a dozen of those, the first club to serve veterans. It's not about being a veteran, it's about serving veterans. When it comes to organ donation, it's about getting the word out so we can get that out. It is a serious cause, but to make it more vibrant, I'll take a page out of what our Rotary Club to End Human Trafficking does. They have different professionals who deal with this that aren't Rotarians, but a surgeon that removes the barcodes that have been tattooed in someone's neck and, you know, those kind of things. So there are other organizations out there that work on that issue. If you can partner with them, it's almost like when you watch a sitcom on TV, you got to bring in a new character every once in a while to add some spice to it. So yeah. I would say bring in some others who are outside of Rotary, and who knows what joint projects you can do together. Thank you so much for that question.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thanks very much. Dr. Sam, you want to add something?
Yes, I just wanted to say hello to Tom. Tom, thank you for being here. You make wonderful presentations. And also, too, if you could go back and pick up on the topic of projects, why these are so important in the clubs, either local projects, international projects, and how can that actually not only bring in new members, because we're using our project as a recruitment tool, but also to sustain membership. And I think that's very important as far as the hands-on project, because people can actually see the outcome of their work, usually in one day or so. Some projects are much longer. But Tom, if you could just share about the projects, why they're so important, and how they aid not only to strengthen the club, but also to help grow the club.
Well, thank you, Dr. Sam, for asking that question, because your question actually goes to the heart of what Rotary really is. You know, it's interesting. Sometimes when we have new directors coming into Rotary during the orientation, we'll ask them, we'll say, what is Rotary? And some people say, oh, it's a service organization. And some people say it's a membership organization. But if you look at our code of policies, which is 585 pages currently, and then there's unwritten rules if you codify, which would be 5,000 pages. But in Article 5, it says that Rotary International is a membership organization. So, Dr. Sam, what I like to say is Rotary is a membership organization that does the world's best service. And let's face it, nobody joins a club to do nothing. They join Rotary for a reason. We talked about friendship as being a reason. There's professional networking. But as I said in my presentation, some people feel like they weren't true Rotarians until they did their first service project. I can tell you some of the most passionate and the most passionate Rotarians are those who have done local service projects, international service projects, or something like youth exchange. You know, being from North America, our group is part of NIAN, North America Youth Exchange Network. And I went to Vancouver a few months ago, and those people are passionate about Rotary. And they are passionate about it because they all share that experience of hosting a young person and seeing them grow. And the stories they tell about how their lives were changed and the students' lives were changed, it's amazing. And Sam, you know, I can tell you about service projects going around the world and doing all that, but what Adonis said about sometimes people can't afford to go on those service projects. Now, there is in certain areas of the world, like in North America, we have the Hearts of Europe program, where it's USAID, US Aid, Government Department, and Rotary Foundation together. In that particular grant, you can actually have travel paid, unless you do one in Ukraine. I'm doing one for my club in Ukraine because there's a war going on there right now. So obviously you can't go there. But Sam, you don't have to travel around the world to Adonis's point. You know, during COVID, I got a call from Tom Thorpenson, who was head of strategy for RI at the time. And he said, we need you to raise $100,000 in your district so we can do a 1.3 million euro grant to Italy, where every district, 10 districts in Italy, got together and they wanted two life-saving pieces of equipment. Well, we couldn't travel, but I still was able to have impact with my club and my district. And I still have friends from there, even though I haven't met them in person. And same with the grant to Ukraine. We can't go to Ukraine right now, but you can. So it's important to Rotary and to what Rotary really is to do those projects. Whether you can afford to travel or not, you can still work on those projects. And our virtual, you know, we have 9,000, which is probably not enough, but 9,000 of our clubs out of the 46,000 are e-clubs. They still do in-person service projects. And sometimes those e-clubs have members from all around the world, but they'll pick a day or a week where they'll do service projects. Then they come together and share those and talk about them. So no matter what your means are, you can work on projects. Thank you, Sam, for the question.
Yeah, I want to add one thing that, Tom, you're talking about the not having to go out. Our club traditionally has usually 2 to 3 international projects, but we underwrite 33 to 37 local grants in Washington, D.C. Each one of these are all projects. And so, one of the stipulations for the grant money they give, that we're invited to participate in your work projects, and we get to visit. So in a year, we may be, the opportunities to attend 1 or 2 or 12 different work projects, and you meet a whole different cadre of people. So thank you for bringing it up, Tom, and it's always great to see you.
It's great seeing you. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we can proceed I would request now Yatish to kindly present our certificate of appreciation for such a wonderful presentation given by Tom. Yatish, all yours.
Yeah. Hi, one and all. This certificate is a small token of our appreciation to our esteemed speaker, Tom Gump, for his outstanding presentation on topic Enjoying Rotary during our online meeting today. Thank you.
Thank you, Yatish. Tom, this will be mailed to you after the meeting. And I would just like to add one thing which Dominica said about enjoying Rotary. Yes, Dominica was right, because myself, Dominica, and maybe Nagjyoti is here. She will also agree with us. She has been regular with us. We must have attended up to 4,000 plus meetings online, and we have made friends across the globe in various clubs. Today also, I did send you a message. So that shows the way we get connected and we enjoy Rotary in a way. Early morning, I had sent you a message about my membership. So we can enjoy Rotary in a lot of different ways, and people should feel that, yes, Rotary is not only for a particular purpose. You have to make them comfortable to think whatever they come in for, they should be given for that. If they are coming in for service, they should be shown service. If they are coming in for fellowship and networking, accordingly, they should be welcomed and they should be treated accordingly. This is my view that I have taken. And moving forward, now I would request, actually, Sayeda from EE Winter Heaven Club was to say the vote of thanks, but she is not feeling well. I request their Vice President Baljeet Ji to please give a well-deserved vote of thanks to the speaker, please.
Thank you so much, and I'm honored to get this opportunity. I mean, 66 of us together here is a very big thing, and I'm really speechless, wordless. I can't say anything how we all connected today, and I must say Stuti did a lot of thanksgiving on my behalf. So I'll cut it short and thank Ajay Jain for starting the four ways saying, and Wayne to say the objects, and Vijay to keep coordinating, and Tom Grump, I am wordless, speechless. Thank you so much. I'm meeting you face to face for the first time, but the way you started, how to bring members in, how to keep the Rotary enjoyable, how to keep the youth engaged, the zone coordination, the peace fellows, councils, Rotarian committees, the president's representations, international assemblies, the Rose Ball Horse. Oh my God, that parade was so exciting, and the national convention. I feel as if I could jump there straight away, and I think all of us are feeling the same. But most of all, the questions that were raised by all the participants, they were very enlightening, and they brought out most of the questions that were lying in the minds of others who couldn't verbalize, and we could gain more from the answers too. Of course, learning about community need assessment approach and the impact assessment, I mean, that was something which I was looking forward even in Rotary, and it is amazing to have you, and thank you so much. I must say, on behalf of the Indian style, we do it like this. Thanks, everybody, for coming in. Thanks to the speaker, to everybody who asked for the questions, the host clubs, and the all the clubs who joined, and the members in specific who were here. Of course, hats off to Tom Grump. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank